Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Kim Ricketts, and I work with Kirsten Wiley on the Microsoft Research Visiting Speaker Series, and thanks for coming out in the rain and on a holiday. Today, we are very lucky to have, I'm going to say Nikos, because that's what he's asked for me to introduce him as, because I think he does not want to watch me butcher his last name. So, Nikos is here. He is a senior partner at Panthea, which is a global consulting firm that works with for companies like ours to develop strategy, or more important than strategy, as he will show you, is purpose. And exactly what he means by purpose and what purpose can do when you fully understand it and pursue it appropriately, it can take companies from being successful companies to being lasting and important and historically changing the business world type of companies, which is what I believe we at Microsoft mean to do. So please welcome Nikos.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. It is the research center of Microsoft, right? Very impressive place to be at. Thank you for the opportunity. A lot of what I'm going to tell you today, ladies and gentlemen, might be counterintuitive, and it might be countercultural also, because it is not something that can be fully empirically tested. But empiricism, conclusions driven from hard data, is only one way of finding the truth. Definitely was not the way of the ancient Greek philosophers. And what I'm suggesting today is that for half an hour, you allow me to go back into the future of how to reflect about human affairs. Let me start with something that is not part of the agenda. Let me start by telling you why purpose is important. I worked on this book for 30 years, mentally and physically for 5. And to my great disappointment, I could not explain to myself or to anybody else why purpose is important until last week. Last week, after the book was published, I went to a book tour in Australia. And on the way back, I flipped through the magazines that the airlines give you, and I found a quote from Nietzsche. Any of you knows who Nietzsche is? Any show of hands? He wrote no software. He was not Silicon Valley. And is there anybody who knows who Nietzsche is? Great. We have enough suspects here to be dangerous. Nietzsche was a great philosopher of a century and a half ago, who lived in Germany, and he idolized the hero, the person who makes the big difference. He said only the superhero counts. I think that if Nietzsche had met Bill Gates, he would have bought Bill a beer. Okay? However, Nietzsche, for all his greatness, did much worse than Bill Gates. For as long as he was alive, he only sold 127 copies of his book. Well, shows you how the world is changing. What Nietzsche said is something very, very pertinent to our subject today. He said, tell people why they should do something. Explain to people why. Agree with people why. And they would be willing to put up with any how. Huh, quite a statement, eh? Okay, for the last 20 or 30 years, that's not how the world has been thinking or evolving. Everybody says, well, give me a tool. Or says, you know, how do I do that? We go to the bookstores full of how to do books. And Nietzsche, someplace from the past, says, how is important, but what is really the most important question to ask an answer is why. Well, that's my thesis. My thesis is the primary challenge of leadership is to address the issue of why. And my submission is that if you answer the question why in a specific way, and we'll talk about it, you can make a great business institution out of a good company. My thesis is not, as just to imitate other writers, that you do what I'm telling you are going to have a great company. Okay? No. You have to have a good company first, then get the purpose as a bridge to greatness. Okay? Let us make this very iterative, because I don't think the environment here, despite my penguin appearance, is very different from what I have been used to in my academic life. How are we doing until now? Whether we agree or disagree, secondary, but are we tracking? Are we following the logic? Sir, I see you a little bit puzzled. Are you puzzled or are we tracking? We're in the flow. We're in the flow. Okay. Very good. Let's see whether this works here. Ah. Okay, that's the book, guys. Okay? Roger Fisher is important. Anybody who has read The Getting to Yes? Okay, enough hands again to be dangerous. In 1975, I met Roger. I helped him develop the first curriculum for the first course on negotiations at Harvard. And at that point, I started contemplating the difference between the how and the what. And what was a cultural shock for me when I came as a young immigrant to this country was how this place was so successful, but also so preoccupied by the how. Who has been born outside of this country? Anybody? Yeah. Does anybody have the same feeling? Did you have the same feeling when you came here that this is a country very much about how, and somehow the questions of what are not that important and prevalent? Why don't you take the? Tell us a little bit about that. Where were you born?
China.
All right. And when you came here, did you have the same feeling that I had?
Yeah. Things are done very efficiently.
Mm-hmm.
You know, traffic is so orderly run. Everything seems to. This is the contrast to places where.
Right.
Not as orderly as here.
Right. I saw that, and thank God I saw it, because I said, Nico, stop thinking about what and why for a few years. You need to make a living. Think about how, right? And I worked and helped Roger build the Harvard Center for Negotiations, which is sort of, in a way, the birthplace of the leadership ideas I have developed myself. But in parallel, because as I said, although I immediately saw negotiations as a means to an end, not an end in itself, for my, at least, intellectual anxieties, given who I was and where I had arrived, I had no option. As I said, purpose is the title of the book. A good subtitle could be purpose and its importance on the leadership agenda. Okay? Because purpose on its own is very important, but what makes the big difference, as the book says throughout, is alignment of purpose of organization, top team, and strategy. And in some place in there, we will put in this construct, especially in response to your questions, I'm sure, the mission, values, and all the other buzzwords that have been proliferating in the last 20 years. So I want to tell you a little bit about what purpose is. And being that I'm a Greek, I cannot explain anything without explaining the opposite. So I will tell you what purpose is not. Then I will tell you analytically what constitutes a purpose, what are the four highways, if you want, to greatness. And then I have some charts put together mostly by associates of mine of your age that tell you again the how to do the why. They insisted that I show you charts like that, so here they are. Okay. Last but not least, it is important to me, and I think it's important to the era that we live in, that we take inventory of what this all means for our lives. I think purpose is important for companies. I think purpose is important for countries. And I think purpose is important for individuals. And people say, go and get a life. Okay. And I don't disagree with that. But my motto is, after you get a life, get a purpose, you get a better life. Incidentally, when companies have to change purpose, it is a big deal, and it is called transformation. When people have to change purpose, it's a big deal. It doesn't have a name, okay? But we can call it personal crisis or reinvention. Just to give you a little bit of a personal testimony, most of you are too young to remember that there used to be a Cold War going on. I was participant in that. I was the head of the F-16 program in Europe. In doing that, I was fighting the war of my father. As the book describes in the first two pages, my family, his family, was shot, all of them, during the Greek Civil War by the communists. So for me to finish that job, finish my father's work, was important, was the purpose of my life. And then in 89, I could fly to his bedside and say, Dad, the communists have been defeated, you know. Incidentally, he came back after 5 years of being out and asked me one very funny question, and how about the Chinese, you know, he worried about that. But I found that to be a bit a bridge too far for my purposes, you know. And I said, okay, done his life, that purpose has been reached, now it's time for me to live my life. Except I didn't have any. Because I had never bothered thinking about my own purpose. Okay, I was always living his purpose. Which, of course, led to something that I suppose most of you have experienced, and if you haven't, one day you will. A little bit of a crisis, a little bit of a reinvention. Okay, like, you roll around, and what do? You go back to Harvard, you know, and you think about it for 2 years, trying to drink coffee, you know. And that's exactly what I did. So purpose is important for companies, and that's what the book is all about. Purpose is very important for countries. I think, with all due respect to my dear immigrant friend here, I think China right now is struggling to find a purpose for the next century. And being rich is not a purpose. Being rich is a milestone. So it's important for countries, but it's also important for individuals. And purpose is not something that Moses will come down from Mount Sinai and will tell a company what it is. Even Bill Gates did not do it this way. Purpose is relational. It relates. The top team, and we can talk about the top team if you want some more later on, the top team, the organization, and the strategy. Okay? How many of you have MBAs? Very good. Would any of you with an MBA hire a strategy consultant? Who would do that? Those who have an MBA and would hire a strategy consultant. That's the problem, okay? There are many strategy firms out there trying to sell the product. And the product was a very hot product 10 or 20 years ago. I used to be head of Monitor overseas. But strategy right now has been commoditized, primarily because there are too many MBAs who can do it on their own. Okay? So strategy is not a bad thing. There is nothing wrong with strategy, except has been commoditized. Because we have trained ourselves as a society and we have produced thousands and thousands of minted good MBAs. Some of them can even use Microsoft software and be quite efficient. Okay? So the strategy is not in. Competitiveness was the very big word in my time because it was not universally accepted as something that people should aspire to. We had the Soviet Union there. We had socialism competing as a system of economic organization. Competitiveness was not in. Competitiveness became very much in became it for very long, especially during the Reagan years, and therefore is passé by definition. And so is the execution. I don't think if you go to China, which happens to be quite populous, you would find a lack of people who can execute things. That's not where the advantage is. It's not in execution. There are almost too many good people in executing things. You might say we don't have enough people who are thinking new things. You might say we don't have enough people who can inspire others. But we don't have a lack of people who can execute things. For all that I know, the three million strong Red Army is full of people who can execute things, you know, in more ways than one. All right? So I think these concepts are passé. And they are passé because we know how to do them, because they have served their purpose, and we're entering a period where the world can afford, having gone through sustainable economic growth for dozens of years now, the world can afford to think about higher things, higher concepts, such as purpose. And what history is teaching us is that questions of morality and questions of culture are questions that are addressed at periods of prosperity. They are not issues on which humans can afford to focus on periods of crisis or of need. The world is not in crisis. The world is not in need, or much less so today than ever before. Therefore, lifting the spirit to higher level concepts is both unavoidable and timely. There are some times that questions of purpose are more pertinent than other times. Mergers is a classic example. Moral problems, problems with implementing a new strategy. Nobody will come to you and say, well, we have a purpose problem. You know, let us go and have a drink. We have a purpose problem, you know. No. But people will come and say, if you're a consultant or if you're talking to a friend about another company, we don't walk the talk anymore. This place is not what it used to be. There is something we lost that we need to go and capture. The energy has left the place. How many people among you have heard friends talk like that about their employers? Can I see a show of hands? You see how important questions of purpose are. Okay. If you add to that questions of public debate about purpose, what's the purpose of Social Security? What's the purpose of healthcare? What's the purpose of going to Iraq in the first place? I don't think there's anybody in this room, or indeed in the Western world at least, that is not exposed to debates about purpose on a daily basis. And this is the highest kind of level of debate one can have. And although it is not phrased in this abstract, philosophical, Greek, if you want, terms, it enlightens and drives and directs all derivative debates. Purpose is the moral DNA. It's the moral DNA of the firm. It's the moral DNA of the country. It's the moral DNA of the university. It's the moral DNA of a person. Purpose is what makes you get up in the morning and go to work, not to just do a job. Okay? Everybody goes to work. Or at least the lucky ones go to work. But there's a big difference between that person who goes to work to get a paycheck and that purpose who goes to work to get a paycheck while serving a higher good. We know that the second person is 30% more productive. Imagine the impact on money, both on the bottom line, as the bottom liners like to say, and on the valuation of the firm when the worker or the employee with purpose, or in a company of purpose, is 30% more productive than the guy who is next door working for somebody who is just there for the money and provides him or her with a check. Purpose is not a mission statement. Mission accomplished. Have you heard this expression? Well, mission can be accomplished, but purpose not achieved. Because mission is something very simplistic, very, very, very tangible. How do you get? It has to do much more with how. Okay, how do you get what you want out of Iraq? You occupy Baghdad. So the moment you arrive at Baghdad, mission is accomplished. Well, but that's not the purpose. Okay, there's a huge gap between purpose, which is philosophical, the reason we're doing something, the essence of things. In French, it's called raison d'être. Versus a very mechanistic notion of mission accomplished, which is I go from here, there. In my second book called Campaigns in Business, I do discuss mission. Mission is very important. Mission and target are important. But they are important on a very short-term basis, for the year, for the campaign. Purpose is about 20 years. Strategy is about 5 years, just to give you some very rough heuristics. Okay?
Vision is the same as mission. Right? But vision is for longer.
I'll tell you, vision, I was expecting the question, and vision is longer, but let me tell you what vision is. Vision is the purpose of one person. Okay? All right? Many people say, I want a visionary leader who will do this and this and this, this for me. Okay? What they want to say is that I want a visionary leader who will relate to my purpose. Okay. Some people have asked leaders to be visionaries. There is no shortage of people who have visions. Everybody here has a vision. Everybody here has at least 10 visions about companies they want to create. That's not the issue. The issue is the alignment with the vision of other people and with the feasibility of the strategy and the organization. That's what purpose is. Vision is the projection of your footprint into the future. Okay? Purpose is the projection of a company and of a top team into the future. Quite frankly, vision is quite American. It is, I'll have a movie and I'll be number one man and everybody else will play around me. And the question is, why? And why is a question that I often ask clients, and some of them from your part of the world, who say, I will go and visit all my factories and I will tell all 150,000 employees of this firm that this firm is about shareholders' value. And they have to work hard to increase the value of the shareholders and the stock has to perform better. And I say, really, Mr. Client? You're going to tell them that they have to do this for the stock? Great. And how many of those 150,000 people have stock? And why should they care if they don't? Can't you find something better to appeal to? See, our vision of ourselves, like the CEO and main shareholder of a stock company that appreciates in the Shanghai Stock Exchange, does not exactly motivate somebody who is not a stockholder at all. Sir?
Well, there are differences in mission and vision statements across yes. companies. I mean, for instance, you know, maybe a soap company would have a mission statement to be the market leader in laundry soap. And then you take a company like Microsoft, where you know, our mission or vision is to help people and businesses around the world realize their full potential. That's a little.
It's not 1 year, right?
Huh?
That's not a one year thing.
No.
And,
no.
You know, when I joined
research,
the
research was done with employees and
customers, but mostly with employees about why they come to work and what really matters to them about working at Microsoft. So the, it wasn't a vision statement that, that just got made up out of the air. So is that coming closer to what you're meaning by purpose?
Well, and actually backing up, like when I joined the company, the mission of the company was a computer on every desktop. Mm-hmm. That had been the mission for I think a little over 20 years at that point. And well, we got there. So, you know, it was time to come up with a different vision. So, you know, can you contrast the two, you know, with like maybe a 20-year time horizon to, you know, a life's work kind of time horizon, which I think we kind of have now.
Well, this place has not become great by having patient employees, right? And you guys are pointing the finger exactly what I came here to talk about. I came to talk about purpose and Microsoft. I'm just two slides away, okay? All right. But spot on, both of you, right? I mean, I know about what you're saying, about the research, And I'm delighted that you mentioned the two missions. Let's come back to that in a few seconds. Okay? All right. Now the real stuff starts. You know, I'll tell you something very counterintuitive. And I don't want to proceed before this is before it is challenged or understood. What works and what does not work over a period of time is primarily a moral statement. Does this resonate with you? How about you, sir? You are a thinking person. You challenged me already. Let us think about the proposition. What works and does not work, which is a practical judgment, over a long period of time is, at the end of the day, moral judgment.
I would not necessarily agree with moral. I would agree with emotional, because fundamentally people are driven by emotions, not logic. Although logic does, if logic connects and resonates with emotion, then you get results. But you do need an emotional connection, I think, to something you're setting out to accomplish, or there's not the there's not the passion and the personal interest that goes into it.
What's your name?
Robert.
Robert says, no, Nico, it's not moral. I wouldn't say it's moral, but I would yield to you, it's beyond reason. It can be beyond reason, right? Or it is beyond reason, you're saying. It has to be beyond reason, right?
You better get joy, personal satisfaction.
So it's the emotion.
There's an emotional connection okay. to the work you're doing, right?
Anybody who has a different idea about that? Sir?
No, if a moral judgment is a judgment against values, and the values are the basis for the actions of people who are acting with against whatever object or product or service it is you're offering, then sure, it's a moral judgment. They are implementing their values by their actions. The success of that, whatever it is going to be determined by overall by their choices of actions. They would use it or not use it. It will do what they need or it won't. And it will succeed or fail to some extent if it succeeds in keeping people choosing it.
They ask who you are, the name.
A lot of responses for that one. I'm Jeff.
Jeff with many responses for his name as Nicholas. Well, who agrees with Jeff? I agree with Jeff, of course. Is there anybody who agrees with Jeff?
You know,
it might be an issue of generational gap, Jeff, but let us see.
Morals doesn't often come into play when you think about delivering Windows.
Uh-huh.
You think about building a great product,
yeah.
But it's not necessary because of moral reasons or moral beliefs.
What's your name?
Pride in technology.
What is your name?
I'm JC.
JC, and you, your name is?
Maria.
JC and Maria, you better go around and have a coffee. And it better be a good Starbucks coffee, right? Because Maria is telling me you are here to help the world, which, right? Isn't that
realize
their potential. Helping somebody to realize their potential.
Can you talk about why people build the products they do and why they care about them, even Windows and very technical things.
it's to help people do more. And people, you know, who work on it, if you go a couple of levels deeper, they will talk about the impact they have. And
I don't think about being the moral thing to do.
Okay. Just let me tell you what's happening here.
I think this is a fine
do
line.
Do you allow me? Let me tell you what's happening here. And it is not the first time it has happened in the English language, you know. The English language many times takes a very nice Greek or Latin word and screws it up, okay? Moral is not the loaded word that you hear when you leave this amphitheater in my vocabulary. Moral is not what the fundamentalists would call right, okay? Moral is what is good. Moral is just a statement about what is good versus what is wrong, okay? Moral comes from morales, if it helps. Cicero used the word for the first time, a Roman orator. Morales means character, okay? Does it show your character? Yes, it does, okay? So think about moral in a very positivistic way, if you want. It's a statement about what's good versus what is not good. What is valued versus what is not valued. What we know from moral philosophy and from studying competitiveness is that there are four ideas that have a following, and you will see where you belong because you have disclosed your moral intuition already, I would suggest. There are four ideas that have lasted the test of time that can provide a solid foundation for purpose. Call it purpose or call it moral purpose if the word moral is confusing. And for most people, Jesse, it is confusing the way it is confusing for you. So take it out, okay? I would submit moral purpose equals purpose, but if the word moral is too loaded for you, for your brain cells, just take it out, okay?
And the value, there was one book I recently read, From Good to Great, Digital
right.
Value. And that value is probably the same as the purpose you're talking about.
China is too impatient, okay? All right. You are a double whammy. You are a Microsoft Research Center employee and Chinese. Oh, my God. Okay? Wait. Okay? Good things are coming. Okay? The joy of technological innovation is the purpose that motivates Sony. They are doing well. They are doing bad. But they stick to it. Okay? Discovery, the new. Okay? In and of itself, the new, especially in America, is good. Forget the word moral, is good. New is good, right? Young is better than old, right? You are better than me, right? Not for you, good. We'll find what works for you. Altruism is good. Like Marie, you said, we are helping people. The word help, we help other people, okay? To reach their potential. Altruism is good. Sam Walton broke the code once upon a time by being very nice to his employees. And when the firm forgot how to do it, look at the results. Excellence is good. Okay? Warren Buffett thinks of himself as an artist. He says, investments are my canvas. Warren does not know how to use a computer any more than I do. Okay? What he knows is how to meet people that he would like to have as dinner guests and invest in their companies. You know, he cannot have that many dinner guests, so he's rather cautious. But he's in a very Aristotelian way, he's collecting the fellows, okay? The few that make the difference. Even when it came to philanthropy, same approach. What counted were the few could make the difference, okay? And then heroism. You know, Henry Ford, I want one of those machines that I built to be in the garage of every house. And he made it happen for 20 years. And you know, the world became a much better place. For one thing, hygienic factors dramatically changed. There was a lot of death and disease as a result of having so many animals having to live in downtown of cities just to address the transportation needs. Okay?
When you're talking about motivating, your initial premise was about there are four things that motivate people, but doesn't it depend on where you sit in kind of a hierarchy of needs and the fulfillment of those? Because if there's, you know, if your basic economic needs are not taken care of, then what motivates you may be very different than these things.
Yield, granted. Okay? Let me tell you the Nicoism on that, okay? Nobody should bother with that if they are not successful. This is not for unsuccessful people, okay? It's a luxury problem to have, okay? And so on and so forth. Just in direct response to your question, it is not how to do well. It is not about how to build a good company. It's about how to take somebody who is successful or a company that is good and make it into a great company, okay? Into a business institution, into a lasting business legacy, okay? Okay, so you're right. It is not about the problems that notions like operational efficiency, strategy, execution are supposed to address. The toolbox for this kind of things is pretty full, okay? I'm taking it to the next stage. And now we're going to start debating. That's how I map some of the companies around us, okay? And by the way, some of these companies had it and lost it and discovered it again. IBM is a good example. Where was IBM 6 years ago? They still thought that by wearing, you know, black suits they could compete with you guys, you know? But the world does have business institutions, and we rely much more on the business institutions than we realize. One of the reasons that I am enamored with telling companies that they have become great by doing well and doing good at the same time is because the impact of the national state is decreasing. Okay. Huge issues that we would expect the national states, the political governance structure of the world to address are left completely unattended. Okay? People might disagree with Bill Gates all they want, but he did take on HIV on his own. As a company, as a philanthropy, there was no United Nations General Assembly resolution. There was not vote by the Congress of the United States authorizing the funds. Some problems have just become too big for governments, and that's very counterintuitive. And we need companies like those to address those problems, because these are the problems of the future. I believe that BP and Toyota, for the little that they have done on the energy crisis, have done more to address the issues of the energy crisis the last 3 years than all governments put together in the last 30 years. Right? So to have a better world in which you guys can see great things happening, we need more of the big companies who are not producing most of the jobs, who are not that productive, but who are there. They are the pillars of our world. To me, to be more purpose-driven, not just money-driven. And incidentally, what we know, and it is, I hope it is clearly established through the research of the book, is those make most of money for the longest time who don't talk about money. Okay? This is one of the paradoxes of purpose. The other being, purpose is a management tool, not just a goal. Okay? That's the beauty of it. The more you have purpose, the more money you make, even if you don't talk about it, even if you don't appeal to the shareholders' value. Second message is you can use purpose and you can use purpose to affect the bottom line. You can use purpose to affect two things in particular that we will see later on. I was coming to see you guys, so my people thought I should have a chart about IT. I don't know what the Penguin is. You guys probably know what the Apple is. But probably you need to put them on the chart someplace. Sir.
I noticed that you do not have in your four items as kinds of purposes, one of which is to make money. And just to...
Well, I mean, look, there's nothing wrong with making money.
I agree.
Okay? Good thing, okay?
The shareholders would tend to agree.
Yes, the shareholders would tend to agree, okay? Some important stakeholder constituencies would tend to agree, okay? If you don't make money, you cannot afford people like me telling you about purpose to begin with, okay?
I'm not critiquing that, saying
hear me. But making money is being fit, is doing something well, okay? Is not going as a purpose, if you want, to lead you to be the Olympic winner. Okay? It's not enough of a turbocharge to get thousands of people motivated to work this 30% extra to make you into an institution over 20 years. That's all I'm saying. Am I? Let me go to my number one critic here. Does this communicate? I'm not saying making money is not. Yeah. Whether it is right or wrong is irrelevant.
Money is an operational thing, and operational things are something that you already have to be doing to even care about this stuff. So,
as a matter of fact, it is even worse than that. I will grant you that. I think making money is an operational thing. Operational thing is the Pareto frontier, for those of you who have done economics. That's making money, right? This is the strategic advantage frontier, making more money than your competitors, okay, than all the industry on average. And this, you have to stay consistent 5 years to get it done, okay? All I'm saying is that there is another advantage that's called sustainable advantage, okay? That to make more money than others over 20 years, you need purpose. That's all I'm saying, okay? It's a very limited proposition. Am I communicating? Sir?
Makes sense to me. Prove it.
I'm sorry?
It makes sense to me. Now prove it.
Excellent. Not yet. So purpose is not, as we said, mission, is not vision, is not values, it is not social responsibility, it's not philanthropy. Okay? Whatever purpose Microsoft has or doesn't have has to do with what...
Oh, but it's still on.
What do I do?
Yeah, there you go. Just put it right.
Otherwise, we can't hear you for the recording.
Another thing about purpose is there is no... purpose doesn't go... Yes, sir?
At the same time, you also went back to his life.
Yeah, you accidentally went back. There you go.
Thank you. Somebody's paying attention to what I'm saying. Ha! I told you it's coming. So it's helping people, not anymore, right? Is it helping people reach their growth? That's Microsoft's purpose?
Realize their potential.
People and businesses realize their...
And if you're going to follow... I'm sorry. Oh, God. Technology. This paradigm, then, Microsoft's purpose is what? Helping.
Altruism,
right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm sorry?
Computer on every desktop maps to where you put before, which was in the heroism box.
Right.
So now you're viewing us in the altruism box, right?
No, no, I'm not viewing you at all. I'm putting you in the box you asked to be put per your mission statement. Okay? Sir.
Do you think that all the people who work here at Microsoft have the same purpose when they come into work every day? Because you're talking to people in the research building who I think you could probably, a lot of people could probably identify with Discovery, whereas if you talk to people in some other part of the company, they might really identify with some.
Brilliant. As a matter of fact, you have it. My first time here, but outside of your building, you do have it. You have a statement to Discovery for the research center. What do we say? 25 years of what?
Turning ideas into reality.
Turning ideas into reality about Discovery. Okay? Okay? So, there is a third purpose lurking around, right? There's an old one, the heroic.
Absolutely. We've got the computer on every desktop. We discover new things. We need to be, you know, consistently operationally excellent, great businesses to continue to make money. You know, we got a couple of pretty decent businesses and a lot of new ones. And then, you know, there's the Walmart box of altruism.
Larry says that, so that's what the research said. Your people would like the mission to be to go back, to go to work every day.
You could put us there, but help people and businesses realize their potential, and that realizing potential thing could also be put in the heroism box. And for the culture of Microsoft, it should probably hit the heroism box, not the altruism box.
What is your job here?
I used to be market research, and now it's a weird job.
Very, Microsoft is the most heroic company of our times. Okay, it's a little bit Herculean. Cleaning the stables, okay? Yes, everything else exists. I think the elements of purpose exist in all companies, but there is one disproportionately dominant, okay? And if Microsoft is not a heroic company, then there is an identity crisis, or my framework is wrong, which I'm not willing to accept. But let us find out. For those who will buy the book, there's a profiler, okay? And this doesn't cost anything. You know, the whole Microsoft population can take the test of what is their moral disposition, what is Microsoft's moral disposition, and whether they fit within 24 hours. Okay, there is no full alignment ever. Okay, but I would be very surprised if in this company the heroic purpose, as long as it is understood by those who take the profiler, is not the dominant one. Okay.
So would you then agree that our mission statement is more of a purpose statement within your framework?
Again, what is it? Remind me.
Would you then agree that our mission statement...
Yeah, but I don't remember your mission statement right now.
Which is to help people and companies around the world realize their full potential. That's our company mission now. Would you view that as more of a purpose statement within your framework than, you know, the mission statements of some of the other companies you studied, you know, about?
You know, it is almost there. It is almost there. What I'm missing, and I cannot real time sort of paint it for you, but it needs some painting, some fine tuning. I think the word help is a little bit misleading, as it is in most mission statements.
I think it's actually
much more clear, okay? let me tell you a joke, because words are very important when it comes to purpose or mission, okay? If the word is help, this is not a purpose statement. If the word is enable, it is a purpose statement.
There were two originally.
I'm sorry?
There were two, and one was to enable people and businesses to realize their potential, and the other one was give people the tools.
Ah, that's even better, okay? Yeah. That's even better, okay?
Tested it through market
tools,
research.
Tools, forwarded. But see, it's not only market research is one thing, but also the purity of logic in and of itself is important, right? Because this is not an altruistic organization, okay? Bill Gates does altruistic things in the evening job, okay? But the ship is not altruistic. First of all, you cannot have so much research and discovery if you're altruistic. It's impossible. It's incompatible. Okay? This is a heroic place. Okay, I mean, when the history of the world will be written, I think Microsoft would be written up as the second, or the most, or the second most heroic company ever,
so
purpose-wise.
Who are we behind in your view?
I'm sorry?
So who are we behind in your view?
Well, there's a competition with Ford. Okay? And one second. And there's a competition with Ford, first of all, because we don't have enough time span. Look what Ford did. Ford forced governments to raise taxes, focused governments on building highways, changed the laws to accommodate the car, changed health conditions, caused wars because of the energy crisis. Okay? You guys might have the same impact, but I have not seen it yet, perhaps because I'm not the most computer literate person in the world. So it might be my problem. It might be happening out there, and I have not realized it.
Wait, they're number one because they caused energy crises, wars?
Yes. Impact-wise, right? No, excuse me. You know what motivated Henry Ford to do what he did? He loved his mother, and he could not see his mother every Sunday morning having to dress up to go to church, come back and, you know, start washing her dress for next Sunday, right? There's no question the car lifted the standard of living of the world dramatically, okay? Big impact, okay? From hygiene to freedom of transportation, to connecting rural communities to healthcare, they did a lot of good, okay? Let's not take this away from them, we cannot. But Microsoft is in the running for position number one, okay? I just have not seen, and perhaps I'm missing it, and if I'm missing it, I want to be told, and this is a good place to be told, the heroic transformation of the whole world around the Microsoft products as yet. Okay? It's there, it's happening. It might happen more in 20 years. And something for this audience that you are not going to like, okay? Great things don't happen in 10 years, then in 20, 30, 40 years. Okay? So quite frankly, you have earned the right as a company to compete. I don't think you have earned the right by mere jeunesse, by age, to win. Okay? So thank you for your patience.
Would you say that something that might be missing from the vision statement as it is now is the value comparison? We want to enable the productivity of people around the world, however it goes, because we value, and then we state what it is we value.
Yeah. With all due respect, can I ask you what you do here?
Sir, I'm a usability engineer. I criticize software.
You criticize software?
Yes. They pay me to say that's bad. Fix it.
Very good. You're the best friend of humanity, I suppose. And you're doing the same thing right now with the motto, right? Yeah. Very astute of you. I think your profile, your footprint fits the job you have. Quite frankly, what you have outside of the building is a little bit too self-indulgent, okay? And a little bit puts you down, because I can go to MIT and see the same thing, okay? An MIT lab might say ideas into action. Any lab might say ideas to action, okay? I think what you have outside of the building is A, fragmenting of the general purpose, okay? And B, not good enough for you. You understand why it is fragmenting, right? Because if the purpose of Microsoft is to enable people by providing the right tools, okay, then I want to hear from you something like your job is to invent the right tools,
my job is to make sure those tools are right. They accomplish what they have to do for the person who's using
them. We cannot put all that on the outside wall, right? But we need something capturing what you're saying versus capturing the general, generic mission statement that you have out there. It's a very generic mission statement that you have out there, which reminds me of a joke from the consulting profession. You know, that one of the three biggest consulting firms in the world decided they needed a mission statement, okay? And the chairman was charged to go around the various offices propagating the new mission statement. And the mission statement was, customers come first, okay? Customers and satisfaction of customers yes, customer satisfaction. Okay? And one day the chairman goes and speaks to a bunch of consultants in London. There's a guy like you there that never agrees with the speaker. Yeah. Okay. And says, Mr. Chairman, this is bullshit that customers come first or clients come first. My girlfriend comes first. You know, my family comes second. My friends come third, and clients might come fourth. Okay. End of the exercise of the mission statement like that. Okay. So you're not here to just bring ideas into action. Okay. If we are missing a nice, good coffee machine in the world, it's not you that will worry about it. Okay? So, some adjustment is needed, and I'm not asking for wordsmithing here. I'm asking for intellectual discipline. Okay? Because we need to align purpose with a subset of values. You know, one of the reasons that I think the value thing is too soft is that not all values are equally important for all companies. Okay, a lot of academics write openness to learning, the most important value for the 21st century corporation. And I say bullshit. Okay? Go to Hong Kong, you know, have a shop that has to produce the low cost, you know, zipper. You know? What do you need the openness to learning for? You just need something else. Okay? You don't need openness to learning. So purpose, subset defines the subset of values that are material. Mission, a little bit about the how. Strategy, more about the how. Organization, but most important of all, people. Okay? Not all of us are equally predisposed for all kinds of organizations. And the most important differentiator in the years to come will not be skills and experience, because they get commoditized also, but psychological dispositions. For instance, if your footprint is not that of a magician, you will have difficulty being in the research center of Microsoft. I think if I'm going to get you all guys to take a psychometric test right now of the four ideal types of Jung, the magician, the lover, the sovereign, the warrior, a lot of you will be magicians. I don't know about you, though. You might be a lover, okay? Because of all this emphasis on altruism. Some more companies, just to prove it, as you said. This is the evidence. This is the positive evidence, and the negative evidence is that no company without purpose can really survive half a century, okay? If you look at every great institution, they had purpose and they lost it, or they had purpose and discovered it, but purpose they had. Otherwise, they cannot last that long. It's the test of time that's the maximum evidence. And the ROEs, you see the ROEs. But to me, this is the conventional proof. The logical proof is, in and of itself, time that an institution lasts. Show me an institution that has lasted 150 years, and there are many in this country already, that did not have a great purpose. Aetna, Citigroup, just name them. Okay?
Does this pattern hold that the heroic companies have the highest ROI?
Yes. You know, because let me tell you why. There's a Porterian answer. Boy, you guys are sharp here. Scale goes well with heroic. Scale does not go well with discovery. Okay? You see? And scale has difficulty with love and altruism. The natural low-cost strategy that allows for economies of scale, right, goes with a heroic purpose. It's a good foundation for the low-cost strategy. Remember, Henry Ford, cost, cost, cost.
One without the other, though. For instance, we can have a really low-cost, high-volume model, but we do have competition, and if we're not innovating, then nobody's going to be buying those low-cost products, no matter how high the produce them. So you kind of need, you know, at least in an intellectual property company like ours, or like Disney for that matter, you need to, that discovery piece, even if it isn't what your company is entirely about.
Yeah, remind me your name again, I'm sorry.
Robert.
Robert. You're damn right, but let me give, I'm going to make the same statement you made, but I'm going to give you a choiceful phrasing, okay? Because I think the world, and especially your world, guys, is a little bit of an illusion on two concepts, quality and innovation. You are not. Your statement was truthful, but I just want to surface the truth here. Quality and innovation, by definition, cost money. Okay, quality innovation move you back from here in the short term, right? Quality and innovation are inefficient processes, okay? More people have been fired for innovating than promoted, right? Okay? So the issue is how much innovation if you want to be a low-cost producer. But there is a tension between the low-cost strategy and the purpose of discovery. Okay, that's all I'm saying. There's a natural tension, just I'm pointing to Marie. Okay? There is no natural tension between the heroic company and the economies of scale and the low-cost approach. Therefore, heroic companies over the long run outperform all others.
So you would view that tension as, for instance, we do invest a great deal in research at Microsoft, for instance, but that's with the goal to productize that research, the eventual goal to productize that research over a fixed time horizon. And we expect a return on that investment. Whereas you would view that a company that's primarily discovery oriented just does pure research with no intent of ever realizing.
No, but they are not so disciplined. So the performance is uneven. Dare I say, mention the name of Apple here? I'm sorry?
So I think we're the biggest seller of Apple software. Or the
so I can mention it. Yeah.
Where does Google fit on your quadrant?
I don't know enough to tell you right now. Why did my people put it there? They had an idea that I had not thought about.
Okay.
I don't know right now. Because it's going through a transformation also, Google, right now, by buying things. Mm-hmm. By the way, to find, so we covered people, assets, history. That's how you find the purpose. To go and find about Google, you need to do all these things. It's not like I can walk into a building and tell you what the purpose here. It's a research project. It's not, doesn't last for weeks. It lasts for 2 months, okay? But you need to go and look at all those things before you come to a judgment. Okay? Important things, okay, and we came to the crux of the matter in this little debate here. How the link happens between purpose and strategy, and what kind of strategy goes with what purpose, and what kind of strategy does not really naturally go, so it needs special attention, is very, very important. And the special attention has to do with the top team. You need to configure the top team in a way that they are smart switches in between the purpose and the strategy, especially when the fit is not natural. Okay? Nope. Jesus. Nothing else? So, find your purpose. PurposeTheBook.com has a free profiler. You can find your personal purpose. You can find the purpose of your company, see whether you fit, okay? And you can use it in your personal lives, of course, because it's nice to have a purpose. It makes for a much better life. But no life is short enough to allow only for one purpose necessarily, okay? My hypothesis there is that's what middle-age crisis was invented for. I've tried it, it works, believe me, okay? And the most applicable, it is most applicable on companies very applicable on countries. Witness how much discussion about the purpose of the Iraq war you have on the press these days. Okay? And the money is in the alignment. Aligned purpose and strategy and top team. And you have built a lasting institution. A company that is not just good, but great. This is the book, and this is the profiler. You don't need to buy the book to do the profiler here. A non-commercial statement, okay? And if the overall profiler about Microsoft is not that you guys are heroic, then we need to do something about it, okay? In the meantime, if you want some free help when I come back to rework what you have outside of the wall, I'll be glad to do it. Sir.
What was your purpose in writing this book?
Rediscovering myself. I'm a completely sort of discovery person, okay? I wanted to rediscover what is indeed leadership beyond what other people write, and which I find rather informed and informative but boring. By reinventing leadership, I also wanted to reinvent myself and to create and to turbocharge my own company, right, Panthea. And I decided that I could not reinvent leadership by myself or with a little startup in London of 30 people called Panthea. So before I launched the company, I sold it because I wanted to become the Bell Labs or the research center of a bigger elephant so I can have the impact. And I held a competing bid between McKinsey, Booz Allen Hamilton, and PwC, who would become my strategic investor with the right to buy the company after when I become 60. And Booz Allen Hamilton won. So what Panthea really is the leadership branch or the leadership department of Booz Allen Hamilton worldwide. So it's about discovery. Very much like this center. And that's why I felt so much at home today, and thank you for having me. Thank you very much.